Thank you, Rajshree, for inviting me. I've been looking at the notion of identity for many years, and through identity design. What I wanted to talk to you about today was design and the Indian identity, something that is actually, you know, touches the work that you do when you work in India. This is my colleague, Bernard. Bernard works in my office in Bangalore. He has passed school, he's married, he has a daughter who's 2 years old. His most treasured possession is his Samsung smartphone. I showed Bernard a bunch of pictures and I asked him to pick out the ones that he thought were Indian. These are some of the ones he picked. And these are some that he did not pick. Had we built up India's infrastructure then, before the advent of telecom and the internet, there would have been a slower osmosis, giving us time to reorient our bearings. However, the fact that liberalization and the technology revolution came together, the speed at which it happened, and the tidal wave of its influence, his home and his office are surrounded by buildings that he thinks are not Indian. Is there such a thing as an Indian identity? And where do its roots lie? The Republic of India is home to so many languages, faiths, ecologies. This is the most diverse as well as the most divided nation in the world. Is there, can there be a common identity that connects its billion plus citizens? And if, as I believe, there is this common identity, how does it manifest in the design of our cities, in our homes, in the things we use? From my colleague Bernard and the many others to whom I have asked this question, the short answer appears to be yes. Whether Hindu, Muslim, Christian or Sikh, whether Tamil or Kannada or Bengali or Hindi speaking, we are able to intuitively determine what is Indian and what is not Indian. We have learned to recognize that certain forms, shapes, and motifs are symbols of our attitudes, of our aesthetic, and of our culture. For the most part, these forms and shapes and motifs come to us out of the traditions of craft developed over centuries in the Indian subcontinent. These have been passed through the generations and have become part of our consciousness. They are embedded in our history and in our myths. We recognize them through stories that have been told and retold through the ages, stories that we can all connect to and relate to. Because our land has been settled for such a long period, we have assimilated and absorbed the influences of many cultures over the centuries. There has been a slow osmosis, a gradual, incremental exposure to new ideas. These ideas have come to us through trade and through being conquered and through being ruled by foreign cultures. This shared culture and these shared symbols are actually much older than the idea of India as a nation and as a democracy. India as a political idea is of comparatively recent origin. The British, through conquest, gave us an artificial unity to a very large land mass earlier ruled by many different states and chiefdoms. It was Mahatma Gandhi and the freedom struggle which imbued the people of this now united territory with a common purpose. But what I am here calling an Indian identity has deeper roots. For something to qualify in our cultural consciousness as Indian, it has to have some sense of history. Often, several hundred years have to pass for it to be acknowledged as Indian. For example, although we were ruled by the British for nearly 200 years, we do not consider colonial buildings to be Indian. Like Bernard, my colleague, we identify them as British. Building in the colonial style, the British used architecture as a visible mark of their identity as rulers. Thus, we view British influences in India as those of the conqueror, the ruler, the outsider. However, the passing of time has allowed us to absorb symbols of earlier conquests, such as the Turks or the Mongols, whose influences have been integrated into our cultural and visual vocabulary. We have now come to believe that they are from India, indeed, that they are Indian. During the freedom struggle and for the first few decades of independence, there was a heightened sense of nationalism, a patriotic fervor. This led us to believe or to define our Indian identity in adversarial or negative terms. To be Indian at that time was to be not British. Mahatma Gandhi thus invoked the spinning wheel and homespun cloth, or khadi, as the authentic symbols of what it was to be Indian. After independence, the Gandhian heritage manifested itself in the cooperative and handicrafts movement. Women like Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay and Pupil Jaikar worked tirelessly in reviving our craft traditions and making them competitive in the marketplace. A different route was adopted by our first Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru. Nehru was a thoroughgoing modernist. In opposition to British colonialism, Gandhi harked back to a traditionalist past. On the other hand, Nehru rejected British colonial legacies by looking to the future. Nehru embraced modernism as the best way to represent the nation's progressive outlook. Modernism was devoid of references to the past and full of optimism for the future. In 1950, in a landmark decision, Nehru invited the French architect, Le Corbusier, to design the new city of Chandigarh. Corbusier's work has been most influential in determining architecture and design in socialist India. Through its public sector, the state took on the responsibility to project the image of India through its built environment. The problems for architects of this time was that the Corbusier school of modernism had little or no connect with the Indian social and cultural context. Since the modern style had obvious state patronage and the state was the chief commissioner of design, the architects of this period felt compelled to adopt this style, which was radically opposed to both colonial and pre-colonial traditions. The difficulty for architects was that buildings, modern though they looked, continued to be handmade by artisans and craftsmen. Machine-made perfection, which was at the heart of the modern aesthetic, had to be compromised by handmade imperfection in India. A third very curious response to British colonialism is illustrated by the construction in the 1950s of the State Assembly in Karnataka. Here, patriotism took the form of monumentalism. The assembly was sited opposite the colonial high court and deliberately set out to dwarf it, using motifs from the palaces of older pre-British rulers. In doing so, the builders of the Vidhana Sauda, who had all spent time in colonial prisons, were thus telling their former rulers that Indian Rajas and Maharajas were better, or at least bigger, than the British Raj. The design experiments of the early years of independence were sometimes elegant, at other times they were soulless or even grotesque. Yet they all had in common a strong oppositional sense. For them, to be Indian was not to be British. Let me now turn to the next defining point in modern Indian history. The opening out of the economy in 1991. What has been the impact of liberalization on the design scene in India? The dismantling of the license permit quota Raj let in goods and services from other countries. This changed everything. Suddenly, our markets were flooded with foreign-made materials. Which were often of better quality and certainly of better design. In the monopolies of the licensed Raj, businessmen did not feel motivated to improve quality as they were secure in the absence of competition. Now there was an increased exposure to ideas from around the world, as well as access to new materials, newer technologies, and global competition. Indian manufacturers were thus compelled to improve their quality standards. Economic liberalization also meant that we could, for the first time, take our own goods and services out into the world. But in doing so, we felt that looking Indian was a disadvantage. This was because Indian industrial products were often associated with poor quality. So to get a look in, our companies tried to make their products look as if they were from anywhere, with no evidence of Indian cultural overtones. This was feasible because English was the language of corporate work in India. To facilitate this, white people were often hired by Indian companies in customer-facing roles. Or Indian employees assumed Western identities. We all know about Siddharth, call me Sid, and Neelakantan, or Neel for short. So to reassure their customers and make them feel at home, business environments in India mimicked those of corporations in America. After liberalization, and for the export sector especially, design in the corporate sector was thus deliberately acultural for business reasons. Our Indian identity was underplayed or suppressed. It only came in the way of success. This suppression of our Indian identity was made swifter because economic liberalization coincided with the telecommunications revolution. I think this is a key point. From one state-owned television channel, the opening up of media networks allowed hundreds of the world's television channels to beam through, bringing global, especially Western influences to the little villages, to the littlest of villages. In the print media, we saw the entry of numerous foreign magazines and publishing houses. It all happened in a great overwhelming rush. Had we liberalized the economy much earlier, in the 60s or 70s, had we built up India's infrastructure then, before the advent of telecom and the internet, there would have been a slower osmosis, giving us time to reorient our bearings. However, the fact that liberalization and the technology revolution came together, the speed at which it happened, and the tidal wave of its influence swept us away in its wake, obliterating earlier ways of seeing and doing. Consider here the transformation in the last 20 years, just 20 years, of my hometown, Bangalore, which for years had been called the Garden City or Pensioner's Paradise. Once it became a center of software, we were told that Bangalore would become India's Singapore or Dubai. This was a strange dream. The world's largest democracy, coming out of an ancient civilization, decided that it wanted to look like a brand new, tiny autocracy. So as real estate sharks colluded with corrupt government officials, tearing down heritage structures, the whole city came to look as if it were built after the year 2000. Charming, understated old quarters, colonial as well as pre-colonial, were flattened. The buildings that have come up in their place range from the undistinguished ordinary to bizarre hybrids, typifying what the architect Rahul Mehrotra has appropriately described as the architecture of impatient capital. Bangalore represents in accelerated form the face of design in India today. For some of us, the fact that we've grown so rich, so quickly, has made us giddy and perhaps quite lost. This is in Bangalore. We forget who we are, where we came from, and where we're going. So it has come to pass that design in India is now quite different from Indian design. As I see it, Indian design is that which has an Indian core at its heart. On the other hand, design in India can be from anywhere. Spain, Morocco, Aspen, or a combination of all, you take your pick. Even our humblest dustbins look as if they're foreign. Think about it. When was the last time you saw a penguin in India? It's certainly hard to see the connect between the homes that people are building and the people them. Oops. It's certainly hard to see the connect between the homes that people are building and the people themselves. Again, who would have thought that a Gujarati couple brought up on Dandiya Ras and Hindi movies would choose to build a house that looked like this? Modern engineering and construction techniques have indeed come to us from the West. So it's not surprising to see us lose our identity to Western idioms of architecture. But what of product design? Here we've come late to the party. Until recently, our products were handmade by the traditional craftsmen that, you know, have been there for generations. Held back by caste prohibitions and lack of modern education, they could not metamorphose into the product designers that industry needs today. To make matters worse, modern Indian education, by and large, is so formulaic and rote-based that it does not predispose us to thinking in the kinds of interesting ways that product innovation requires. In this climate, much of the work done by Indian companies tweaks foreign designs or simply imitates them. As a friend of mine sharply but accurately remarked, in India, the definition of copyright is the right to copy. Manufacturers feel that there's no point reinventing the wheel when it is so much easier and faster and certainly more profitable to alter something that is already successful in another geography. I don't mean to say that we don't make good products in India. Indian products are good and getting better. But it's hard to think of a single industrial product made in India in the 20th century that can be truly considered to be of Indian design. Sorry, I'm having some trouble with this. Yeah. What we've proved to be better at is innovation in process design. For example, we're good at figuring out how to set up processes that will reduce the cost of manufacture. The Nano is an example of such innovation. And that's why Arvind Eye Care in Madurai has performed some 4 million surgeries with over 30 million patients at a close to free cost. Let's turn next to textiles and fashion. India has had centuries of tradition in the making of saris across all of its regions. No other country can match the endlessly rich designs, weaving, printing, and dyeing techniques, and the fineness of craftsmanship seen in the sari, this incredibly versatile garment that has endured thousands of years. Given its longevity, it's extraordinary how quickly the effects of globalization are affecting the supremacy of the sari. I was looking at recent issues of Vogue magazine, the Indian edition, and was intrigued by the fact that out of 256 pages, 3 to 4 pages alone had design which had any connect at all with India, either through the choice of garment or pattern or motifs or craft. The other 252 odd pages did not reference anything Indian, although there were several pages showcasing the work of Indian designers that looked very much like the work of Western designers. If Vogue is as influential in forming opinion as I think it is, then this is rather telling. Other celebrity magazines, which showcase the wardrobes of socialites and celebrities, reflect the same situation. In industrial design, we got off to a late start. We don't have the type of education that fosters innovation, and we know it's going to be hard to catch up. So it's not surprising that we're underconfident and imitative. But why must we be so slavish and derivative in textiles and apparel when we have deep, deep expertise? Why are we so hastily moving away from an extraordinarily versatile garment that was good enough for women, rich and poor, for thousands of years? One reason could be that the roles of women have changed more substantially than ever before, as more and more of them enter the workplace. To acknowledge and communicate this change, women reject the sari as they feel that it's the symbol of the traditional stay-at-home woman, submissive. Girls don't want to wear the same dress as their grandmothers, and they don't, because they don't behave like their grandmothers anymore. This may not be expressed explicitly. When asked, they often cite functional reasons for not wearing or moving away from the sari. But because the textile and garment tradition is so deep in India, we have not as yet completely thrown out the baby with the bathwater. We've adapted and come up with our own hybrids. It's interesting to see how in the last 15 years, the Mughal-inspired salwar kameez and kurti have become ubiquitous in the wardrobes of the urban woman from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. The dupatta references the sari, and the garment is an interesting evolution which incorporates the wonderful weaving, printing, and embroidery techniques that India offers, but adapts them intelligently to contemporary needs while retaining an Indian identity. Now let's consider next the case of advertising design. This seems to have emerged higher up on the confidence quotient ladder. Advertising is clearly motivated. It has to sell. In order to do this, it has to understand and connect with the inner mind of the consumer. More than in any other discipline, advertising designers engage with people, trying to understand their dreams, hopes, and aspirations. Moreover, they must communicate in the language of the consumer, which more often than not is not English, but Hindi or Gujarati or Punjabi or Tamil. Unlike in architecture, corporate and product design, which are still mostly derivative, advertising has moved from a colonial hangover pre-liberalization to a field which has a strong and confident Indian identity. They have done this by taking their cue from that great Indian creation, Bollywood. From the West, they have learnt and improved their production skills, incorporating state-of-the-art visual and sound technology, creating films and commercials with superior design and art direction. But in terms of message and content, in order to touch people's hearts and minds, in order to make them laugh or cry, they draw directly and wholeheartedly from Indian culture. To illustrate this, let me show you what I mean.
Green plywood, janam janam ka saathi.
Na marbadi mugla, paak teya.
Savitri.
Swami.
Savitri.
Swami.
Having surveyed the design scene in different sectors, let me come in the end to prospects for the future. Where must Indian design go in the coming decades? I must say that I'm hugely optimistic about the future. Every day I see more evidence that interesting, fresh, and culturally relevant design thinking is gathering momentum in India. Yes, it's slower than it should be, and as yet too fragmented to be called a movement, but it exists and is gaining strength. Of that I am sure. There are several reasons for this phenomenon. First is the shifting balance of power between the West and us. Now that their economic and political dominance is on the decline, the West is looking towards India with greater respect. They see opportunities in the purchasing power of our growing middle class and in the wealth of our upper class. As we become richer, we are more able to afford their goods and services. We, for our part, are delighting in this newfound status. Today, a middleweight brand manager in a mid-sized Indian company confidently sends inquiries to the world's largest design companies, saying that he has a project. Within days, a clutch of designers are on a plane to see him, with slick presentations in hand, anxious not to miss out on a piece of the Indian action. He might not have a project at all, but is chuffed at how important he has recently become. There's no doubt that Brand India's perception in the world has changed enormously in the last 10 years. As the West look at us more admiringly, we sense their admiration, and it's making us less awestruck. As the world values us more, we value ourselves more. Secondly, liberalization has unleashed a huge amount of opportunity, and young, enterprising Indians are full of ideas that take advantage of it. As we grow richer, we become more confident and are willing to take more risks and try our hand at new things. Thirdly, our sense of self-preservation is finally going to make us realize that our chance at glory lies in celebrating our uniqueness and not in merely aping the West or any other culture. Indian fashion designers are realizing that there's no point competing with mega brands from the West to recreate the little black dress. Finally, there's an unquestionable resurgence of pride in being Indian. And while this has manifested itself very quickly in areas like music, and could Bollywood ever get more powerful, in design terms, what does India have which nobody else does? The answer should be clear. It's our infinitely varied and infinitely deep craft traditions. It is foolish for us not to take proper advantage of this amazing resource, which we've sort of relegated into the background, you know, after liberalization. It should be the bedrock of Indian design, as it has always been. It will enable the blurring of disciplines as it did in the past. Think of Ellora. Is Ellora art, architecture, or design, or craft? I'm certainly not suggesting a revisionist agenda that revisits a glorious Ram Rajya of design. Rather, I'm suggesting that we call upon what comes naturally to us. In cultural terms, India has always been the home of incorporation and accommodation. We now need to affirm our syncretic tendencies, to embrace the modern and integrate it with the traditional. Only then will design in India mean the same as Indian design. Thank you.